Hi, this is Richard Barbieri from Porcupine Tree. We're at Air Studios and we're trying some things out here. One of the things I'm trying to establish is what's going to be the setup for our live shows. It usually goes through a few stages. So I'll start with what I have here, and then as we go along in the process, I might find that some things might not be working or I might want a replacement. So it's like a fine tuning, really, of having the right gear at your disposal for the material that you're going to play. Because, of course, as well as the new album, we're going to be doing a lot of back catalogue stuff as well. So it's a hell of a lot of sounds. Usually my setup revolves around a bit of really old kind of analog stuff, a bit of kind of mid-era virtual analog, and some software. So in this case, the software, I'm running instruments in Reason, propeller heads Reason, and I'm controlling that with this particular Nord. So there's no sound coming out of this. This is just USB to the computer, but I really like the action, and it just feels nice. I have a workhorse kind of instrument which will deal with all kind of electric pianos, mellotrons, Hammond organ, acoustic piano. That's a lot of that is needed. When Stephen gives me demos, it's usually he's covering mellotrons and pianos and organs. That's always a kind of staple. And it ends up being something that needs to be there. This V-synth, Roland V-synth, I've had for 20 years, I think now. So I think it's the best thing they've done. I don't think they've done anything better since, to be honest. I love it, and that's very useful. Virtual analog, but very performance-based. A lot of controllers, D-beam controllers, and time trip pads. So a lot of what I do is to do with control. I'm not a great technical keyboard player. So for me, it's more about the controls than the actual keys. And I tend to make kind of one key do more rather than try to play 100 notes. This, like this one, this is an Access Virus synth. It's this has been pretty amazing. It just seems to work in anything. It's like a kind of a Hammond or an electric Wurlitzer, where you play it in any track and it just fits in. I can't describe it. Even though it's digital, it's very organic sounding, and it fits in so well with Porcupine Tree's music. Been using that on nearly every album. This is pure analog. This is a SEO2. It's a collaboration between Roland and Studio Electronics. It's a really beautiful, beautiful little analog synth, three oscillators, very powerful. It's a bit different for me in that it's kind of more akin to a Moog than it is to the synths I'm used to using. So it's quite big and the filter opens wide, and it's not so precise. It's just this big, warm kind of sound that really makes its mark. I mean, very strong kind of lead and precise kind of sounds. I've had the original Prophet 5 since very early 80s, and it's probably one of the synths I'm most associated with. And this is a complete recreation of that, with a few little added extras along the way. But for me, just having something that's more compact, but everything is where it should be, and all the sounds track exactly the same as on the original Prophet. It's amazing. So I'm really pleased with this, and I've got a serial number 5 on this one as well. So one of the first ones. So it's a mixture, and an interesting addition is this looper, a loop station from Boss. This could be quite a creative thing that you can use live, in that you could feed instruments through and build up on textures on top of each other. So if you're doing something on the fly, or you want to instantly create this kind of multi-layered atmosphere, you can send any one of your instruments to that and start building up loops, and then that will come back at you. Then you can add over other things. It's also very handy for samples, recording your own performance. It just seems to be a good thing to have on the road. I'm sure it will have plenty of uses. So I'm pretty much covered, really. A couple of nice effects, the TC flashback, which this synth is going through, and this is going as a send to the desk if I just want some reverb, which I might not need in the places we're playing, but just in case that's there. And the mixer set up, I've got my clicks, I've got the band, I've got my own keyboard, so it's pretty much all under control. Harridan, Stephen already had the main electric piano. He wrote this with Gavin. So I think he was playing a Wurlitzer at Gavin's place. Now, when you have sounds that on the album sound brilliant, they don't always translate live. So if you were trying to play that live, it would just get swallowed up. You know, but obviously in a mix, you can bring something way to the fore. And so it's a whole process of finding the right sounds, but there's a general kind of... That's kind of going through the verse. At the same time, there's little kind of... little effects. When Stephen does a kind of interesting little voice or vocal or a lyric line, I sometimes introduce sounds that just kind of gives it something special behind it. So we have all that kind of stuff going on. Then we have the mellotrons, of course. Now, I'm not totally happy with this sound yet. This will develop over rehearsals and more programming sessions. I've already got an idea to get a better kind of a wider kind of sound than this. And then between each verse, you have like these lead lines. When we get to one of the dynamics sections, it's kind of like the metal section, I guess, in the middle. The guitars are playing a kind of metally type thing, and I'm just decided to kind of mix just the one note in with that. And solo over the top. Now this is quite an interesting sound for solo. Then we have there's a sequencer part in the middle as well. This is kind of the quirky track, and this is more of me, more representative of me within the group. It's more of what I do, and Stephen reacted to that rather than Stephen give me a demo that had his kind of flavours already established. So this probably, if I was given too much freedom, would be the way that Porcupine Tree would go, I guess. Let's have a look. So we just have a basic part in the verse. First is quite kind of moody, spoken voice. Big chorus. The main thing is the middle section, I think, is where it gets a little bit odd. Gets quite dark. This is something that I've got to build more on, probably introduce other effects and textures to that, but I think some of the things we need to wait and see what it's going to be like when we're all playing in a room at the same time, and then see if there's still some space or how best to kind of work this middle section. I write a lot. I know that most of them are never going to be taken as songs for sure, or even instrumental pieces. I've got a success rate of about 1 in 12 with Porcupine Tree. So for probably 12 sketches that I'll put forward, one will hit the mark, and then that will be further developed. Because you know we all come from different musical backgrounds, and we all have our own solo careers. And there's just one point where they all meet, and that becomes Porcupine Tree. It's where all those influences, our friendship, the way we work with each other and our dynamics work together. Everything else that's on the periphery, it doesn't make its way in necessarily. But I think this track is a good demonstration of the kind of, let's say, more abstract and weirder side to Porcupine Tree, and it's something that I can work with Stephen in that way, but Stephen will work with Gavin in a completely different way, which would be far more physical, musical, and they can work together in a room and feed off each other. I guess my thing is a bit more inside my head, and it's a case of just supplying him with ideas. And that's the whole thing of working with synthesizers and electronics. Brian Eno said that it was an instrument in development, which I suppose it is. It's never really ending. You could come in and you could be playing a gong mixed with a distorted trumpet. And that's kind of the beauty of it, is that I have that palette that I can bring to the group. Whereas obviously the guitarists are gonna work within their own parameters. But mine are kind of, there's more possibilities with what I do. Also, I bring a kind of non-musicianship to Porcupine Tree, which I think helps. Because I think if I was a very proficient player as such, I think we would be an entirely different band. So my weaknesses are my strengths as well. It's all about context with me, because I'm not sure that I've changed my approach in I don't know, 40 years. I just think that it sounds maybe unique in terms of just it's in another context. I can't say I have a different approach. I mean, what my main aim was, and when I started, it was to kind of introduce sound and abstract sound and sound design within the context of pop music. And there wasn't really anyone doing that apart from Brian Eno. And there hasn't really been anyone doing it since in that kind of way. You get great electronic artists who work on their own and they create their own thing. But to create that within, say, a rock band or a pop band, or even with jazz musicians, that's something different. Yet my approach is always the same. With all of Stephen's songs, I listen and I just kind of, I have a map. I have a kind of, and it's to do with lyrics, it's to do with the sound, and I just envisage what should be happening dynamically, where the space is and how things should tie together. So with this one, for me, it was all a case of crescendos here and there. Things coming and then disappearing, and then leaving space for the vocal and then for the guitar refrain that takes you into the chorus. Then things get a bit more dynamic, and then it's all about these little kind of clusters. And so, for example, in the verse, there's a kind of marriage of three parts that works best when it becomes blurred. So, for example, there's a kind of melody I came up with, which is... which features a little bit first time, but then it will play again, but it becomes blurred by another kind of thing here. So you don't hear the notes so clearly, but there's something going on. That then is, we add this to it. Let's find this. Without fuzz. That's a backing that you would never be able to pick out every part, but it just all comes together to make this kind of wash that goes behind the voice. One important part of the Prophet and kind of the sounds I use with this is that I don't really use what we call frequency modulation, which is... you hear a lot of synth players using lots of... for expression, but I always use noise modulation, and I don't hear other people using it very often, but it's this. And then going back to the track, we get this kind of dynamic section, but then at the very end, it all completely kind of, the coda really comes down dynamically, and we kind of fade out with the, I became obsessed with getting this kind of rain sound, but it's always best not to get the sound perfect. It's got to be an approximation, because then you have your own take on it. So for me, this was rain. And with that, we end on a chime. As the guitar's just fading out. So that's just an initial idea of how I'd approach something. I wouldn't be thinking, right, I'm going to play this and then I'm going to play that. It's not like I'm going to be going... I'm not thinking about making a statement with notes particularly. I'm trying to build an atmospheric backdrop. Everything is slowed down and it's all about how the sounds evolve. In the dynamic section, there's kind of a organ, but not organ. Sometimes I prefer programming organ sounds on synths. It just has kind of more character. I don't think I was actually influenced by keyboardists. My main influence was like badly tuned radios when I was a kid, because I would try to listen to music and I would get two channels at the same time. And it would make these amazing sounds. And I used to think, God, I love that song. But it wasn't a song, it was two songs, and it wasn't supposed to be together. And so that, for me, became my inspiration for making sounds. Brian Eno was the biggest influence because of what he was doing with Roxy Music. That's what I wanted to do with the band that I was in at the time called Japan. I wanted to use these abstract sounds, but make it work within these songs. I always liked Joe Zawinul because he kind of played the sound as it should be. He made these kind of quite ethnic. He was obviously into African music heavily, as well as jazz, but he was into lots of different world musics. So I really liked his approach. I think world music was a big influence on me. All those instruments. I tried to recreate a lot of these things on the analog synths. So, for example, you've got a very normal kind of sound. Quite basic. What I would try to do is create interesting harmonics so that you still have the security of the notation, but you have something added into that sound. So... Okay, so you have your basic sound, so you've got your, but here, there's always something that's a little bit different about the sound. Always has a character or has an interesting harmonic or an overtone.